is Josh Byerly at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. On the phone with me now from Moscow, Russia, is astronaut Reid Wiseman. Reid has actually been going through what's called immersion training over there in Moscow, where he basically lives over there in Russia. Reid, tell us a little bit about exactly what that entails and what it's like and what you've been up to the last few weeks.
Well, Josh, I think the first thing I need to say is it's great to hear English being spoken, so I really appreciate that. I've been over here for 5 weeks now, and it's a 6 week program, so it's coming towards the conclusion. But basically, my daily routine revolves around a 4 hour lesson with one of three Russian instructors, and then we eat a quick lunch, and then we head out onto town and do some sort of immersion type of program, whether we go to a museum or go see a show, an orchestra, a ballet, something along those lines, to basically get a full, not only language, but cultural immersion as well.
Now, you're doing this, obviously, because the Russians are one of our partners for the International Space Station, and you, one of these days, will be living on board the space station. It's important to, learn how the culture works over there. I think it allows us to become better partners with the Russians and obviously with our other international partners. Have you been, over there learning a little bit about the space station, or is it simply just a culture-only type of exercise?
Well, for me, it's a cultural and language exercise, but it is certainly geared towards life on the ISS. So when I'm in class doing the language training, it's not just general Russian. We're always gearing it towards space applications and information kind of leaning that way. So it's really well organized. It's a pretty fine-tuned machine at this point in the program.
You know, the first time that I went over there, I was struck by how warm the culture is over there. I mean, they're very warm people. They treat you almost like family whenever you're over there with them, especially whenever you're working with our partners in Roscosmos and their other contractors. And they take their accomplishments in the space program very much to heart and very seriously. Have you seen sort of the same thing?
It's amazing you say that. The first impression I had when I got over here was just how friendly and nice the people are. It's not that the culture is quite as open as we experience in the United States, but once you just say hello to someone, they are really interested in continuing the conversation and taking care of you as much as possible. And then they really are a proud people. They're proud of what they've done in history and what they've accomplished in space. And I think that rings through everywhere I've been in Moscow. It's just there's a lot of pride in Russia and its history.
What's sort of been the biggest challenge for you over there? I'm sure that, the language is not exactly easy to learn, but I think it's, once you're over there living among it, it's probably a little easier than just sitting in a class trying to learn it. But other than that, what's sort of been the biggest challenge for you?
The biggest challenge for me is I did about a year and a half of Russian training before I came over here in Houston, and I felt like I had a good basic level of Russian. And then I came and I'm living with a host family and just sitting down at dinner with them and trying to take part in their conversation and understand the jokes and just make small talk, by far that's the hardest step in this program. And so far it's been a great program for learning that.
How has how's the weather been over there? I'm sure it's a little chilly.
Well, I've been keeping my eye on the Houston forecast, that's for sure, just to see what's going on back home. But right now in December in Moscow, it hovers right around 32 Fahrenheit every day, and you never know if you're going to get a little bit of rain or a little bit of snow, but it never really does much. I think weather-wise, the thing that surprised me the most is it's almost always cloudy, and the sun isn't out. It's not out very long in the day, and it's low on the horizon. So coming from Houston, where it's hot and sunny all the time, it's definitely been a difference for me, and it's been a little bit difficult to adjust to.
Yeah. Now, for those people who have never been to Moscow, Star City, which is where the cosmonauts and our astronauts train, is actually sort of outside the main part of Moscow. I'm assuming you've been out there and been around the facilities out there, haven't you?
I absolutely made it out. The second weekend I was here, I got invited out to Star City, and I went. It was a nice little excursion from downtown Moscow, and it really amazed me how well NASA has kind of brought America over to Star City and given us a fairly comfortable little existence in Star City. And it's an incredibly interesting place to walk around and think of the history that's happened there.
Yeah. Now, you're part of a group of our astronauts, our newest astronauts, that actually will not fly on the space shuttle. And I think that a lot of people in the public don't realize how much more intense the training for station actually is, because it lasts about 2.5 years, and about half of it's in the U.S. and about half of it is over in Russia. It's radically different from how crews train for shuttle missions, which, of course, were, you know, upwards of 2 weeks long. You're actually living on board the station for about 6 months, so the training is much more rigorous and intense. Have you started to sort of move toward that? You know, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, I will start my dedicated space station training in January with my first dedicated trip to Star City. But for now, I think the biggest difference between what would have been training for a shuttle flight and the station flight is, for station, we have a broad spectrum of very general accomplishments that we need to take care of in order to operate for 6 months, whereas I think the shuttle crews were much more focused on the details of the mission, and we just don't have that luxury.
Now, talk a little bit about the perspective of somebody who was a naval aviator, and obviously NASA has an extremely long tradition of naval aviators. Some of our most famous astronauts were naval aviators themselves, and, you know, people that are applying to become astronauts now, they're not going to get to fly something as iconic as the space shuttle. They're going to be doing long-duration missions up on board station. You know, one of these days they'll be able to fly Orion, which is going to go further than we've ever gone before, which, of course, is exciting. But is it different now whenever you look at, you know, you're actually not going to be launching and landing in a shuttle versus just traveling up to the station? Is it a different mindset, or what are your thoughts on it?
Well, having never flown shuttle, I really can't talk to the mindset so much, but I think that being a naval aviator and the experiences you get in that profession, or really any military profession, they translate extremely well into NASA. We're looking for operationally oriented people who have been out working under extreme conditions, long hours, and I think the military background just prepares you brilliantly for that. And so far, I think that working around the ship, flying day and night, it's been a great kind of fundamental knowledge for me coming into NASA.
You know, a lot of questions we get a lot of times, whether you're an astronaut or you just work at NASA in general, is people go, well, how did you get that job? How did you get from here to there where you are now? And I think it's simple as people just need to find out what they're interested in and go apply for it. So with that in mind, how did you go from growing up in Maryland to going into the Navy and then, you know, coming to NASA, becoming an astronaut? Was it sort of part of a master plan? Is it something that you just sort of moved toward logically throughout your career? How did you get from point A to point B?
Well, Josh, it was a tiny bit of a master plan and a whole lot of luck. I think being an astronaut's always been kind of in the back of my mind, but the odds just seemed a little long. So it was never really a primary goal that I was reaching for, but I watched the Blue Angels fly over the Naval Academy as a kid growing up near Annapolis, and that just sparked an interest in flying for the Navy and flying in general. So I went into that career path, and then as my career in the Navy progressed, it seemed like being a test pilot would be a fun job to do. So I did it, and it was a great time. And then, of course, that's one of the best ways for a military person to get into NASA, The path just aligned itself, and it all worked out back in 2009. I think the biggest thing is whatever job I've had, I've always just been happy, and that's what I tell people is don't take a job because you want to become an astronaut. Take a job that you love doing, and then if the stars align, then that's a great result.
So talk a bit about the process. You know, you applied to become an astronaut. It's a fairly lengthy and rigorous interview process. Give people some idea of sort of what that is like, because, I mean, I think people probably wonder, you know, what is it really? It's not exactly a normal job interview, is it?
Oh, it's far. Well, being a military person, normal, nothing is normal, I guess, for me for a job interview. But it certainly was a crazy experience. So I sent in my application, and then close to a year later, I received a phone call. Hey, we'd like to interview you for a spot. And that was just a super day. I'll never forget it. And I came down to Johnson Space Center. And just walking into the interview room was, without a doubt, the most nerve-wracking thing I've ever done in my life. And I'd like to say they make it easy on you. Everyone is super nice, but they set it up so it's almost a little uncomfortable for you and awkward sitting at the table and trying to look at everybody and talk to them and tell them your story and why you would fit in great here. It's pretty difficult, but it's a very interesting process. And then, of course, there's the medical side. So the way I looked at it when I came down for the medical round of interviews was, this is going to be the best medical exam I will ever get in my life. So whether or not NASA works out, at least I'll know that I'm a healthy person at the end of this. And so I was always trying to look at the bright side as the process was going. And for us, for the long duration class that they selected, they broke it into two separate interviews. So I came down one time for 3 days, and then when we got called back for finals, there was, I think, 47 of us called back, and we came down. That was almost an 8-day process, and it was much more rigorous, much more in-depth, and I think from there they were able to make their decisions.
You know, there's some astronauts that they get accepted on their first try, and then we have some that have applied several times and finally broken through. So people that are sitting at their jobs now, whether they're military or non-military, whatever it is, and they're thinking about, you know, should I apply for this? What's your recommendation? What are some words of advice to those people?
If you have any thought of flying into space and working at NASA, it does not take a lot of time to throw in that application on USA Jobs. And to me, it's just, why wouldn't you do it? Simply the experience of coming down and interviewing and learning about the nation's space program is worth it. And then if everything works out and you get offered a job, then hey, that's just a great outcome. But in the end, I think it's absolutely worth taking a few minutes to drop that application. You never know what's going to happen.
Has it been as exciting and cool as you thought it was going to be?
It has absolutely been as exciting and cool. It's definitely, any job is going to be different when you get there and you start getting into it. It's a difficult job. It really requires a lot of concentration. It requires some long hours and a lot of training and preparation for a flight that sometimes seems very distant in the future. But overall, when you look at each day and what you're doing, one day you're in a spacesuit, then you're in Russian class, then you're flying a T-38, and then you're working robotics and on and on and on. And just that entire experience wrapped up in one is phenomenal.
So now that you have wrapped up your immersion training, or almost wrapped up your immersion training over in Russia, what's next up for you?
Well, in the short term is getting home and seeing my wife and kids, who that'll be a great time, and they're very excited to see me. And then long term, like I said, getting ready in January to start my 2.5-year training track for a 2014 launch to ISS. And then I think on the sidelines, it's also going to be really enjoyable to watch the rest of my classmates as we integrate into the office and work in the different branches and really become the future of the human spaceflight program for our country.
And do you sit there and do you see the space station, you know, whenever we've got it on NASA TV, or you talk to the fellow crew members that are up there, and do you realize, I mean, does it sort of hit you that, okay, I'm going to be actually living on board this thing here in about 2 years?
It definitely hits you. I think it's going to hit me a lot harder when I'm strapped in a Soyuz in 2014. But I still just look at it in awe and with that childlike excitement of getting up there and doing it.
That's a great. I think that's a great feeling for people to know that, you know, it's becoming very real, you know.
Absolutely.
Well, if you'd like to learn more about Reid, just log on to the NASA website at www.nasa.gov. You can take a look at his biography or any of the other current crop of astronauts. If you would like to learn more about applying to be an astronaut, just log on to www.nasa.gov/fly-nasa. Reid, we want to thank you, and we hope you have a safe trip back here to Houston.
Josh, thanks a lot. I appreciate it. I appreciate your time.
I'll see you later.
Take care.